This is a 2020 Porsche Cayenne Turbo S E-Hybrid Coupe, which is a ridiculously long name. It's also the newest version of the Cayenne, and it's different from the other models in two ways. For one thing, it's a coupe, except, you know, it isn't really, but Porsche says that it is. But also, it's faster than all the other Cayenne models. This has 670 horsepower. And today, I'm going to review it. Let's start with the basics. Now, you already know the Porsche Cayenne, which is Porsche's midsize SUV. And you also know the Cayenne Turbo. I've already reviewed that. It's the top-of-the-range gas-powered model in the Cayenne lineup. Well, then above that, you have the Cayenne Turbo S. Except you can't get a regular Cayenne Turbo S anymore. If you get the Turbo S, you get a plug-in hybrid like this one. And it's fast. And I mean really fast. This car has the Cayenne Turbo's 540 horsepower twin-turbo gas-powered V8, but then it's combined with an electric motor for a total of 670 horsepower. 670. Just to put that in perspective, this is closer in horsepower to a 918 Spyder than it is to a base-level Cayenne. And there's another major difference between this and the regular Cayenne. This is a coupe. Well, sort of. Porsche calls it a coupe, but what that really means is it has a more sloped rear end design than the standard Cayenne. I personally can't see much of a difference, and it certainly isn't a coupe in the traditional sense of being a two-door car, but I guess it is coupier than the regular Cayenne. A little. Of course, putting massive power in a Cayenne and then coupifying it comes at a price. In this case, it's a pretty hefty one. This version of the Cayenne has a starting price of $165,000, and then this one adds options from there for a total sticker price of just over $190,000, almost $200,000 for a Porsche Cayenne. Anyway, today I'm going to take you on a thorough tour of this Cayenne, and I'm going to show you all of its interesting quirks and features. Then I'm going to get it out on the road and drive it, and then I'll give it a Doug score. All right, I'm going to start the quirks and features, and probably the most important part, and that would be with the coupiness. Now, this whole coupe SUV thing is becoming a trend. BMW has the X6, which is a coupe version of the X5. Mercedes has the GLE coupe, which is a coupe version of the regular GLE. And now there's the Cayenne coupe as well. Interestingly, Audi and Land Rover also have their own models in this segment. Land Rover has the Range Rover Velar, which you can see here. And Audi has the Q8, which is sort of a sportier version of the Q7. Those aren't coupe SUVs in the traditional sense, where you take a standard model and just add a sloped back. And as a result, the Velar and the Q8, in my opinion, look way better than all of the coupe SUVs. To me, the whole coupe SUV thing is kind of lazy. Automakers are desperate for new SUV models, and this must be an easy way to get one. You take an existing model, you slope the rear end, and then poof, you call it a totally new vehicle. The good news is that the Cayenne coupe is the best looking coupe SUV so far. The X6 is really not attractive, same with the Mercedes GLE, but Porsche did a good job of coupifying the Cayenne. With that said, it was probably pretty easy to turn the Cayenne into a coupe because the regular one is already kind of sloped. And here you can see the two next to each other. There's not that much of a difference here. It's not like they took a squared off SUV and really made a sloped rear end. Instead, these are two fairly oddly similar vehicles when it comes to the back-end design, so going from the Cayenne to the Cayenne Coupe, most people probably won't even realistically notice the difference between the two. Now, that relatively small difference between the Cayenne and the Cayenne Coupe on the outside is also carried into the cargo area. Most of these coupe SUVs have a dramatically smaller cargo area than the regular version, but not here. You look in the Cayenne Coupe, you can see it has a fairly large cargo area, reasonably practical. Compare with the regular Cayenne, same basic idea, same basic shape, not a huge amount of difference. And when you look at the numbers, that really proves true. The Coupe has about 54 cubic feet of cargo space. The regular Cayenne has about 60. So there's only a 6 cubic foot difference, or about 10% lower if you get the Coupe. Not a big number. And it's basically the same story in the back seat. Usually when you get a coupe SUV, that sloping roofline steals rear seat headroom. I could barely sit upright in the back of the Mercedes GLE coupe. Not so here. I'm about 6'3" and I sit back here and I have a couple of inches between my head and the ceiling. It's really not a problem in the back seat. There's a lot of headroom even though you have a coupe SUV. And the way they were able to do that is interesting. You look on the outside and you do see this sloping roofline and you think there's going to be trouble for rear seat headroom. But if you look behind that and into the center of the roof, you can see it's actually higher than the sides. So the roofline on the sides is what you see. It makes this look coupier than normal, but the roofline in the center is what actually gives you the headroom. It's a pretty neat trick. It gives you the look of a cool coupe SUV with the headroom of a normal SUV, so you're not really giving up anything. And another notable difference between the coupe and the regular Cayenne is pricing. The coupe is only around $2,500 more expensive than a regular Cayenne. Now, usually I bash these coupe SUVs for being more expensive and less practical, and that is true here, but the price difference is really not all that much. So while I'm still not the biggest fan of coupe SUVs, in this one, at least you still get a pretty attractive vehicle, and you don't give up much cargo space or rear seat headroom, nor do you really pay all that much more for it. And since we're discussing pricing, let's talk about some of the more notable items on this car's window sticker, starting with the color. Porsche calls this ridiculous color lava orange. I call it the traffic cone's big brother. And if you want your Cayenne painted in this color, you will pay an extra $3,200 just so you can drive around with a Cayenne that looks like a big traffic cone. Now, I admit this color is interesting and quirky and kind of fun, but it's far more fitting of a sports car. And given that price, I suspect nobody is really going to pay to paint their Cayenne lava orange. And next up, another interesting item on the window sticker of this Cayenne is something called the lightweight sport package, which is an interesting thing to see on a vehicle that weighs over 5,600 pounds. I am not making that up, 5,600 pounds. But the lightweight sport package does decrease that weight by 70 pounds, which I'm sure is tremendously noticeable on the racetrack. Now, the lightweight sport package costs almost $13,000. For a 70-pound weight savings, 13 grand. And it includes several different things. I'm going to show you two of my favorites. One is the roof, which you can see is carbon fiber. Not a typical painted roof here. You have a cool carbon fiber roof like a sports car, although that does mean you don't get a sunroof. Even better than the roof, though, is this interior. You have houndstooth seat centers instead of full leather, which is just so cool. I guess the theory is this saves weight over heavier leather, and it looks like a vintage 911 or like a sporty GT3 with its cloth seat center. I don't really know if it's an effective weight savings measure, but I have to say it does look really cool, these seats. And speaking of the Cayenne Coupe doing its best GT3 impersonation, it carries that theme around back to the rear wing, because there are two of them. You have one fixed in place at the top of the tailgate. You can see it's fairly large, air passes through a rear wing. Then you have another one down here at the base of the rear window. Right now it's in its folded in position, but when you get up to a certain speed, this rear wing opens itself up to provide even more downforce, for your 5,600 pound SUV. Now in past Porsche models, there was a button in the interior you could push to put up the rear wing and show off to everyone as you drive along. That is no longer the case. You can go into the infotainment system and raise the rear wing to put it into its service position for servicing or cleaning, but once you start to drive away, it goes back down until you get to the speed where it activates to come up automatically. And since we're around back, let me go back to coloring for a second. I want to talk about the badge, and specifically the coloring around the badge. You can see is this kind of bright neon green. Porsche calls this acid green, and they use acid green accents like this on all of their hybrid and plug-in models. Look at the front fender, and you have a similar acid green trimmed badge up there, the green going around the badge to signify that this car is green or environmentally friendly. Now, I don't have a problem with the acid green trim around the badges, but in this car, you also have acid green brake calipers, and they are massive, as they have to be to stop this 5,600 pound SUV behemoth. The issue is the acid green doesn't really go with the lava orange. They very much clash, and it looks really strange, as if you needed another reason not to spend $3,200 extra to get an orange Cayenne. And speaking of that acid green color, Porsche has carried it into the interior as well, and specifically into the gauge cluster. You can see on the tachometer, the needle is acid green, not your typical red or white, but you have that green color. And same over to the left, the speedometer, it's digital, but it has an acid green colored needle, just like the tach does. But my favorite acid green display is in the middle, below the tachometer, you have a gauge marked E power on one side and charge on the other. And they will light up in acid green depending on how you're driving. If you're accelerating hard, it will use E power, telling you that it's using up some of your electric power, your battery. If you're braking, it will regenerate battery power and restore range, and then the acid green display switches over to charge, and you can see it's doing this all the time, constantly as you're driving, depending on your current driving style, and it's just kind of cool to watch as you're driving along. And next up, speaking of the gauge cluster, I want to show you some of the technology in this car. I've already shown you a lot of this stuff in my reviews of the new 911, the 911 Turbo, the Cayenne Turbo, which I'll link in the description below, but I do want to hit some of the highlights, starting with the gauge cluster, and especially the fact that I love the tachometer. It just sits there in the middle when the car is off, this old school analog tachometer, like it's in a sea of black just floating in place, and I think that looks so cool. When you turn on the car, I love that the little screens next to the tachometer kind of light up to flank it, and they also look really cool. It's a neat look in this gauge cluster with the old school tachometer front and center. Now, as for the center infotainment screen itself, again, I've already covered this in greater depth in other reviews, but it's a fantastic system, works really well, very responsive, and it's a cool feature I like. It recognizes your fingers as they approach. You can see the system currently looks like this, but as my fingers get close, it senses they're coming, and a few more icons appear on the screen, giving me more choices. I remove my fingers for long enough, those icons go away for kind of a cleaner look, and then as I inch back forward, they come back. It's kind of a cool thing to have finger sensing infotainment technology. Now, one other item worth noting in this infotainment system compared to others I've reviewed is that this has a hybrid section because this is a plug-in hybrid. And if you go into the hybrid section, it gives you various different displays and statistics about how you're using your electric power. This Cayenne can go about 20 miles on pure electric power before the gasoline engine kicks in, but you can regenerate some battery life while you're driving, and you can kind of always monitor how all of that is flowing using this tab in the infotainment system. Also, one other cool thing about the infotainment system, go into the center console and you get this cool cloth that says Porsche on it, which is designed to clean the infotainment screen. So you don't just get a Cayenne with your 192 grand, you also get a Porsche branded cloth. And next up, also infotainment related, is the camera system in this car. Now, to activate the camera system, you can put the car in reverse and the backup camera goes on, of course, or you can press this button in the ceiling, a P with a little camera, and then the cameras come on. And there are some interesting items worth noting about this camera system. For one thing, right now you can see the backup camera is on and it looks like a fairly standard backup camera, but you press panorama and it changes to a wide angle screen right before your eyes, which is an interesting effect. effect, and you can toggle between the two and kind of see the camera angle change, even though the angle isn't really changing. To me, though, the best part of this camera system is the fact that it swivels. Check this out. I'm in reverse. You can see the backup camera's on, and then I turn the steering wheel, and it actually swivels in the direction where I will be backing up. And you turn the wheel the other way, same deal. It swivels the opposite direction. It also works like this for the front camera. Put the car in drive, get the front camera on. You start turning the steering wheel, and the front camera starts swiveling to where you're going to go so that you can see it a little bit better. That's a cool idea that more automakers should really implement. And next up, another interesting function of the camera system is that you can clean the rear view camera from inside the car. Check this out. You have the camera page up on the infotainment screen and you press clean. And then there's a little washer next to the camera that will actually wash off the lens and clean it so you don't have to get out and dirty yourself by cleaning your camera. Your car will do that for you. And next up, another feature I like in the infotainment system relates to this black kind of button panel below the center climate vents. You can see there are various different options at the top of this little panel, and if you press them, it will bring up your corresponding display in the infotainment system. So you don't have to go through different menus and find all the displays. You can just tap each one of these little areas in your button panel and pull up whatever you want. That's a pretty cool feature. In case you get lost in some menu in your infotainment system and you just want to quickly pull up your climate controls, well, just tap the climate button and it will go there instantly. It's nice to have those backups down below. But I'm not completely sold on this black button panel in the center console. I do like how it looks when the car is off. It's completely dark, which has kind of a nice clean look. And when you turn the car on, all of your buttons light up to let you know what they all do, which is a neat effect. I'm with it so far. My problem comes with the blanks. If you look at it in direct sunlight, you can clearly see there are blank buttons that never light up because you didn't get those features. In this car, that includes ventilated seats. You can see where the ventilated seat control would be if you had ventilated seats, but they're not there. You spent $192,000 and you get a look at a feature that you don't have. You would think that the whole purpose of an electronic button panel would be to eliminate blank buttons for features that you didn't get. But apparently that's not the case here. And the same is true with the sport button. You can see there's a sport button that never lights up in your button panel. That's because in this car, the drive mode is controlled on the steering wheel. You can switch between all your drive modes with this little wheel coming off of the steering wheel. That means there are more drive modes than just sport, so the sport button isn't necessary, and yet it sits in there useless. And you can see it in some lights. It's kind of a weird way to do it. And by the way, speaking of that dial on the steering wheel with the drive modes, you can see you twist it and it adjusts between all the drive modes like you might expect. But in the middle, there's also a button. You press that and it activates the sport response, which gives you an extra burst of power for like 20 seconds. If you want like a quick highway pass or a pass on the racetrack, and you can see it actually counts down the 20 seconds in the gauge cluster. This feature has a very obvious feeling in the Porsche sports cars, but the Cayenne is so heavy and massive, you press it here, you don't really feel that extra burst of power, but it's still a pretty cool thing to have. And next up, we move on to the back seat in the Cayenne Coupe, and the first thing you notice when you look back here is there's only two seats. I guess you lose the middle seat because you have the coupe model, and so you don't need that practicality. So you just have two seats on the side and then this little storage panel in the middle instead of another seat. Now, with that said, one nice luxury you do get back here is a full rear seat climate control system. You can see the screen and all the controls here in the middle, and you have two separate zones back here, one for each rear passenger to control their temperature independent of the front seats. This four-zone climate control system only costs an extra $1,000, which is a bargain by Porsche standards, so it's probably worth doing if you're going to be frequently carrying rear seat passengers. And next up, another cool feature back here. On the rear seat headrest, you have Turbo S debossed into the leather. Many automakers will do something like that in the front seats, but most of them just skip it in back, but not for this car. Turbo S on all four headrests. And next up, I want to talk seat folding. Now, unlike a lot of other high-end luxury SUVs, you can't fold the rear seats from the cargo area. There's no control back there to fold them down. Instead, you have to use this little latch on the side of the seat and then fold it down manually with the back doors open from the back seat area. Now, it's worth noting, even if you do that and fold down the back seats individually, they don't ever really fold flat. You can see this is as far as they go. It's pretty flat, but it's not completely flat as compared with the floor in the cargo area. So if you have some fragile item that has to stay totally flat, you might run into some issues with this vehicle. Now, the reason these seats don't fold flat is because of the bolsters on these seat bottoms. You can see these are far more bolstered than basically any other rear seat, I guess so rear passengers will stay in place in their seats when you're driving on a racetrack with four occupants. And finally, we move under the hood where you can see the engine. Now, like I mentioned, this is the same 4-liter twin turbo V8 that's in the regular Cayenne Turbo. It's just that an electric motor is also added, and that's where you get the horsepower. 540 horses from the gas engine, but a total of 670 horses with both combined and about 665 pound-feet of torque. It's a massive number for a massive vehicle. Since I'm up here, one other interesting item worth noting is this sensor in the front grille. This is the sensor used for radar cruise control and all the forward safety systems, and it just looks ridiculous. For some reason, Porsche is the only automaker that has this like giant circle, and they have to take a section of grille out, and it looks bizarre. And I don't really get why it has to look like this, especially in 2020. It's such an obvious thing, and to me, it kind of messes with the look at the front of the car. I wish they would change it. And so those are the quirks and features of the 2020 Porsche Cayenne Turbo S E-Hybrid Coupe. And now it's time to get it out on the road and see how it drives. All right, driving the Cayenne Coupe, Turbo S E-Hybrid, whatever. A few things I noticed right away when driving this car. I drove this before I looked up the weight, and I'm not at all surprised that it weighs 5,600 pounds because it feels as though it weighs 5,600 pounds. 670 horsepower should be a massive number that should send it to 60 in like 2.8 seconds. Instead, it does 0 to 60 in 3.6. Now, that's not slow by any means, but a car with 670 horsepower these days should probably be a little quicker unless it weighs 5,600 pounds. And when you go around corners, you can also feel it is a big and heavy vehicle. Now, Porsche does a lot to mitigate the weight. This car has rear axle steering. It has really sharp handling. It has a very quick transmission, which makes it feel even quicker. But at the end of the day, it is still a large vehicle. And when you're really pushing hard into a corner, as I've done with it, you do feel that heft. Now, as for acceleration, I put it here in Sport Plus, have some charge. Oh, it is just a monster. Woo-hoo-hoo. It is a total and utter monster, like very few other cars on the road. Crazy. The thing to me that's really cool is it pulls so hard even at high speeds. You drop the hammer at 75, 80 miles an hour, and it still pulls really, really hard. It feels really, really fast. But I will say it doesn't feel like the fastest SUV I've ever driven. The Urus does feel faster. The Trackhawk to me does feel faster, and I think the numbers might prove that. The Model Y Performance and a Model X P whatever D, those are all kind of quicker. And I think there's a lesson here, which is at some point, curb weight really can't be thought off. Now, it is worth noting that the regular Cayenne Turbo Coupe only weighs about 5,000, 5,100 pounds. It's the hybrid system that adds so much more weight. So it makes this car faster by adding more power, but it also really slows it down. I think it adds about 400 to 500 pounds. With that said, this is a surprisingly fun vehicle to drive. I find it to be pretty enjoyable, pretty exciting, obviously very fast. It handles a lot better than you'd expect given its heft. Porsche just does the best job and always has in just making even larger vehicles feel like sports cars. The Panamera, the growing 911, they're getting bigger, they're getting more luxurious, they still feel sporty, and this is a good example of that. And so that's the 2020 Porsche Cayenne Turbo S E-Hybrid Coupe. Frankly, I think the coupe aspect of this whole thing is kind of stupid. It's not really much coupier than the regular model. It's less practical, it's more expensive, and I don't really think it looks all that different or better than a standard Cayenne. But 670 horsepower is not stupid, and the performance here is impressive. Then again, so is the price. Anyway, now it's time to give this Cayenne a Doug score.
Starting with the weekend categories and styling, the Cayenne Turbo S Coupe looks fairly nice for a coupe SUV, but not any better than a regular Cayenne, and it gets a 7 out of 10. Acceleration, Porsche says it does 0 to 60 in 3.6 seconds, and it gets an 8 out of 10. Handling is good, especially for a vehicle this size, and it gets a 6 out of 10. Fun factor is decent, it's huge and SUV-ish, but still a hoot to drive, and it gets a 6 out of 10. Cool factor is okay, given the color and the new coupe body style, it's a little cooler than a normal Cayenne Turbo, and it gets a 6 out of 10 for a total weekend score of 33 out of 50. Next up are the daily categories and features. It's well equipped for the class and it gets an 8 out of 10. Comfort is normal for the class and it gets a 7 out of 10. Quality is excellent, top-notch materials and reliability is strong and it gets an 8 out of 10. Practicality is good, normal for a car like this, and it gets an 8 out of 10. Finally, value, and it combines a lot of great stuff, but it's insanely expensive to get there and it gets a 6 out of 10 for a total daily score of 37 out of 50. Added up and the Doug score is 70 out of 100, which places it here against other high-performance SUVs. It just edges out the regular Cayenne Turbo, but stops short of beating the Lamborghini Urus. Still, that's good company for the Cayenne Turbo S Coupe, especially because it's ahead of basically every other performance SUV. Personally, I'd still rather have an E63 AMG wagon, though.
But it's worth noting that Porsche doesn't only bring the acid green color from the outside into this interior, they also bring the exterior color in here as well. Let me show you what I mean. I'm sorry, I couldn't resist. And I suspect nobody is gonna pay that money for this color on a Cayenne.